they had to devise a way for each of these long distance switching machines to connect with each other and talk with each other. Because every time your call went from one machine to the next, that information about your call had to be transmitted to the next machine so they would know how to complete the call. Okay. And as you pointed out earlier, the early machines used dial pulses, right? So kind of like this. How long does that take, right? That is really time consuming. And time consuming is a problem when you're talking about long distance circuits because time is money. Long distance circuits are very expensive, and it's also where the telephone company made its revenue. Okay? So it was not an advantage to tie up that long distance circuit for taking a long time sending that pulsing information. They had to devise a better way of sending that information. And in the 1940s, they did that using something called the multi-frequency in-band signaling system. Okay? Multi-frequency meant that it used two frequencies for each digit. Okay. In-band meant that the frequencies were transmitted over the same telephone long-distance circuit that your voice was over. So all of the tones that were used had to be in the voice frequency range. Okay, usually nominally a few hundred to a couple thousand hertz, you know, seconds per second. And so in that way, using those tones, you could transmit that dialing information vastly faster than the old way possible. So let's show you what that sounds like. Here we go. That's it. The entire telephone number was transmitted in less than 1 second. Okay? So much faster, much less time tied up that expensive long distance circuit. Yeah. Now this still had some disadvantages to it, okay? Among that being that you still had to tie up that circuit if the number you were calling was busy or if the number you were calling didn't answer, right? So if you called a number that didn't answer or you called a number that was busy, there would be no charge for that call, right? So no revenue would be produced. So, that was still kind of an issue that they were working on a solution. There was also an unanticipated problem using the system. One that they didn't think about. And that is the very nature of the in-band signaling system. When you make the call, you can hear that in the background, right? Well, let's suppose you're a college kid at MIT or something like that. And you're listening to that, and you're saying, what is that about? What happens if I record those little noises and play them back? What happens if I can go to my toy organ or something and play the same tones back through the system? What if I can build a little gadget that I can hold in my hand that reproduces those tones? What could I do with that? Well, we could do a lot with it, as it turns out. If you had built this little gadget, known as a blue box, you had access to these machines in a way that you would have never imagined. Because you could then connect not only to regular telephone numbers, you could connect to switch rooms, special service numbers, inward operators, late route operators, all kinds of people all throughout the system. You could connect to and talk to them and have them set up special things for you. You want a test circuit between Dallas and New York? No problem. There it is. The other thing you could do is you could dial internationally. Now in the 1960s and not until the late 1970s, you couldn't dial internationally, right? You could if you had the little blue box. And people would do that. There was a popular telephone booth in that Victoria Station there that they would call up just to check to see if the weather was. So this was all a lot of fun, right? It wasn't a big problem. The Bell system started to gain noticing that this was going on, and they thought, we may need to do something about this. But they weren't terribly worried about a bunch of college kids who were in. What was worrisome is that what if somebody starts manufacturing these little gadgets and selling them to people like bookmakers and things like that? And there were people who did that. A couple of guys got this bright idea. They were phone freaks. They liked playing with this stuff. And they thought, we could probably make these and sell a few of them. So a couple of guys in Northern California did just that. And they didn't do any big production thing. But later on, when after they had been very successful with their second company, the one that didn't make blue boxes, they said that, well, if it weren't for our first organization that built the blue boxes, we never would have made our second company. Any idea what the second company was? Begins with an A. No.
Apple.
Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs, the phone freaks. And their little blue box is now on display at the Computer History Museum in Mountain View, California. If you ever get around there, I suggest you stop by. So this was then an issue that became a problem, and measures had to be taken to monitor this and to solve it because of the potential of revenue. Happily, Bell Labs had been working all along on a newer type of system that would be out of band or disconnected from the actual online service itself. Remember the earlier problem I told you about, that you have this issue of tying up these long distance services? What if you could avoid doing that altogether? And not have the connection made until the other party answered it. And that's exactly what happened. They got rid of the multi-frequency system and came up with a new system called Common Channel Interoffice Signal, CCIS. And they use a variant of that still now. Mostly Signaling System 7, I believe. And what that did is it divorced the signaling portion from the actual talking portion of the phone call. So let's take that call, that theoretical call from Seattle to New York. So you make your call to New York, and the number's busy. Okay. Seattle sends high-speed data to New York, New York sees that the line's busy, sends high-speed data back to Seattle, saying, sorry, that number's busy. Seattle then sends you a busy tone from Seattle. No long-distance circuit was ever established. Okay? Similarly, if the number's ringing and the other party doesn't answer, no connection is made until the other party picks up the phone, then boom, the connection is made. So you're maximizing the efficiency of your long distance service. And you've also gotten rid of those really pesky little blue box things. Okay? Much better. So that's where we are today. Any questions about long distance signaling? There was another little anecdote to this, which I'll mention. Part of this whole process is something called the single frequency condensing. And that handled what is called the supervisory part of the call. What that means is, has the party hung up or off it? Is it hung up, or is it busy, or is it not busy? Okay. When a system or a trunk of twin systems had nobody using it, it would send a high-pitched whistle in either direction. Okay. Signifying that the trunk is disconnected and not in use and available for use. So one of the favorite tricks of the phone freaks back in the era was we had a buddy of yours on a live distance call. He just goes like, blow that little tone. Most of them knew how to do it just by whistling it, and the call would disappear. Because it would hear a disconnect signal, but it would whistle when you did that. And that was also used in some signaling to transmit number of dial pulse things that used bursts of that 2.6 kHz tone to accomplish that. The other thing, ironically, was that the phone freaks discovered that there was a little whistle that was in a box of breakfast cereal called Cap'n Crunch, and a little plastic whistle that just happened to make that particular frequency tone. So you could then make phone calls by going into that little whistle. One of the best-known phone freaks took his name from that cereal, and has been known since as Cap'n Crunch. Any questions about any of that?
Why would they choose to transmit when it's free versus the other way around? Like transmit nothing while it's free, and then play something when it's busy. Why would they send a tone when the thing's open versus not sending a tone when it's open and sending a tone when it's closed?
Interesting question. I have to think about that
one. Well, I'll step in for just a sec. Remember.
Hi, this is Sarah from the museum. So I turned the camera off there since I didn't know how to hold it at myself and talk at the same time, but I still thought I'd like to give you an answer to the question. For those of you who couldn't quite hear it, the visitor asked, why would you send a 2600 hertz tone down the trunk when it's on hook and remove it when it's off hook instead of the other way around? It seems a bit counterintuitive, right? Well, maybe. At first glance, it seems strange to send a tone down a trunk that's not in use, but remember, these tones are in band, so 2600 hertz falls right in the range of human hearing. So if you sent that tone down the trunk when it was off hook or in use, you'd hear a loud whistling sound for the entire phone call. Anyway, I just thought I'd try to clear that up. Thanks for watching.